Today's agenda of the session is to learn about the basics of electric vehicle powertrain components. So to start with, we all have played with electric remote control cars in our childhood. So if you see, that has two motors in it and a steering control, a motor near the steering control as well, right? So how is a production electric vehicle is different from the remote control car which we actually played in our childhood? The physics seems same. Even we need motors to run the car, and but what is happening? What are the things that are adding up inside the electric car when it scales up from that remote control technology to the production car on the road? So these are the different components that are added into the electric vehicle system that make the electric vehicle system different from our remote control car. So today we'll be discussing about all these components and how they function and how they help electric vehicle to function and ensure the safety of the driver, like the people who are using, the consumers of the electric vehicle. So these are the different components of the electric powertrain. These are the components that are there in electric vehicle that are not there in the combustion vehicle. So these are the battery pack and accumulator and BMS and IND, insulation monitoring device, pre-charge, inertia, switch, shutdown circuit, motor and drive. We'll discuss a brief about how many different kinds of motor are there, what are technologies that are evolving in kinds of motor. So these are So if you look this bike, this is an electric bike. It might not look different from you. From the point of view of a consumer, it might even appear like a engine driven bike, an IC engine driven bike. So you can see after electrification, the electric vehicle has no significant change in their appearance. So only thing is you'll not have any exhaust. So if you see here, there's a motor here, and there will be a battery pack here under the hood, and there will be a controller in the fuel tank. Okay, so this might not be specific with every manufacturer, but this is like, there's a 110 kilowatt sports bike, which you're looking at. It's again electric. It has a fastest record of 0 to 100 kilometers per hour ever, like recorded till now. So all the circuits are in the result and it all looks same. What is the flow of energy in our electric vehicle. So the storage of energy is the battery pack. Okay, so the battery pack cannot itself store energy from nowhere. So we have to pump energy into the battery pack using charger. So from battery pack, we have this small three guys here who make sure the power goes properly to the motor controller. And then we have a motor controller and the motor along with all the control circuits like accelerator or the driver controls. So today I'm not going to discuss about driver controls. I'm only going to discuss about the whole power part, the powertrain part inside the electric vehicle. So the first in all the electric powertrain components is the accumulator. So what is accumulator? Accumulator or battery pack? So what is an accumulator? Accumulator in general sense is a storage of energy. It's just any storage of energy. Even you can call a fuel tank as an accumulator. Component that stores energy is called accumulator. Here, these are the batteries that store energy in electric vehicle in the form of DC. So how does one decide what should be the size of the battery pack and what kind of batteries have to be used in a vehicle, and what are the complications in the battery? Nowadays we have. In the olden days, even the electric vehicle, they used lead acid batteries. So lead acid batteries are bulky. So, and if you want to drive in current day technology, in current world, if you want to drive around in a city in a car using a lead acid battery, a whole you will not have any space for consumer except the driver in the car. You will be filling all your car with lead acid battery for a range of 100 kilometers or 200 kilometers. So then this is a problem in lead acid batteries, because lead acid batteries are cannot deliver higher voltage. They can have a higher ampere rating, but then it is going to take a lot of space in the car. So in order to solve this problem, we electric vehicles generally nowadays use lithium ion cells. So lithium ion cells, again, there are several types, cylindrical cells and prismatic cells. The picture you see here is a prismatic cell unit. Okay, so generally in accumulator container, you'll have cells. Along with cells, you have an insulation material and a busbar path. So what is problem? What is the problem with lithium ion cells, and why it is very challenging to design a battery pack with lithium ion cells? Is lithium ion cells cannot be heated more than 60 degrees centigrade, or in some technologies more than 45 degrees centigrade, and they have they should be charged in specific way and should be discharged in a specific way. You cannot over discharge, overcharge or over discharge. So what I mean by overcharge is you cannot charge them more than their voltage level. Whereas this case is not so hazardous in lead acid batteries, but it is hazardous in lithium ion batteries. So lithium ion battery is like our fuel tank. They are also like a ticking bomb if you don't properly protect them from all this overcharging, over temperature, over discharging, and over voltage. So that's why we need our next component, which is battery management system. Okay, so the lithium ion cells, because they cannot be left alone without being monitored like lead acid cells, we had to have this component. So what does this component do? How does it protect or regulate the health of the lithium ion cell, the specific way when to charge? So this component, this particular component, will be monitoring voltage of each and every cell in battery pack. So how does it monitor each and every cell? So it need to be connected with each and every cell, right? So in lithium ion battery pack, another challenge is to route all these low voltage wires into connecting the battery pack at the same time, making sure this battery pack is not discharging current into the voltage sensor wires. Okay, so it also monitors temperature of the pack. So once if the temperature of the pack reaches more than 40 degrees, what does it do is it communicates with the controller, hey, you're drawing too much of current and the batteries are becoming so hot. You have to cool down. So you cannot withdraw so much current for little amount of time until they get cooled. So if you see in Tesla, you have a ludicrous mode, and you cannot have a ludicrous mode for more than once. If you do a ludicrous mode, after some time, only after some time you will be able to do the ludicrous mode again. So who is telling not to do ludicrous mode? There is BMS, because that is what is monitoring all cell parameters. What happens in ludicrous mode is your cells are discharging 10 times more than they have to. They can discharge normally, so more than 10 times, some X amount of times more than what they are able to discharge, and then they'll overheat, and even the motor overheats, and the whole system and whole system of the car will be overheating. So until the cooling system cools the whole system again, the BMS tells controller not to discharge this fast till sometime. So apart from this, because the lithium ion chemistry is very sensitive, you need to monitor the health of a lithium ion cells. You should be changing the parameters of how you are charging them, how fast, how slow, what should be the current it is able to charge. So in lithium ion cells, the interesting fact is the majority of catastrophes are happens only when they are charging, not when they are discharging. So the BMS is a good companion to charger. and it always tells charger how to charge the battery pack. In a way, it's not going to create any calamity. So as I said, overcharge is like, the BMS also monitors the current. So when the current is reaching more than what the cell can discharge for an amount of time, it'll also monitor it and tells the controller to set the controller limit according to the battery state of health and state of charge. So what is SOC? State of charge. What is SOH? Is a state of health. So this is a another interesting fact is BMS is cannot control the cell. BMS just can monitor the cell. So what it can do is it can tell, nobody can control how much current is being drawn, how much voltage is being given to the controller, because BMS is in low voltage part. So how does it communicate? How does it take over the safety of the system? Is just by a single component called a contactor or a AIR, accumulator isolation relay. We'll discuss it in the next slide. So this person here, AIR, accumulator isolation relay. So through this two contactor, these are the switches. These are the switches that can be controlled by an electric signal. So our BMS will tell this accumulator isolation relay and main contactor to shut down in case of any over temperature and the controller is not able to control the current, then it will shut down the system. So whenever you switch on your car, electric car or electric bike, what is happening is first the battery pack is being checked by BMS, and then BMS gives a green signal saying this relay can be switched on. Once this is switched on, only then you will be able to start your vehicle. So how will you start your vehicle? By switching on this main contactor. So these contactors are the special components which can carry 400 amps, but they can be switched on with a 12 volt supply. Okay, like the general relay use. The relays only can take 24 volts, which we generally use in our normal circuits. But this can carry, it is a separate mechanism. It can carry around some 400 volts and 400 amps and 500 amps, even 1000 amps. It is used in industry and it is adopted into the electric vehicles. So that's how BMS has grip over the safety in the system regarding the batteries. Okay, so next is in our component list is IMD, insulation monitoring device. So before going into explaining what is IMD, I would like to explain a little bit about insulation. What is insulation? So why do we need insulation? Insulation is, so you would have played with, you have, if an electrician comes to your house, he would be coming with a tape in his hand and he'll be very skillful in opening and cutting the tape and in applying the tape everywhere, whenever he cuts the wire. So that tape is an insulation, but instead we will not have any tapes inside the car. There are several other materials which have different temperature rating of insulations and different voltage ratings of insulations. And there's a lot of research into insulation. So in electric cars, instead of tapes, you will have nylon fiber or the glass fiber sheets or nylon sheets or the Teflon sheets. So there are like several kinds of sheets and the tapes that can be like materials like acrylic between the battery packs. So all these are all the insulations and heat sinks everywhere. So these are the insulations that are used in the capabilities. Now it is a car, sir, of 400 volts. So anything about 660 volts can be catastrophic to human. When a human comes in contact with 60 volts of DC, it's going to, and if he's exposed more than 30 seconds to that voltage, 30 or 1 minute to that voltage, it's going to stop the heart because if the path is through the heart. Okay, so that's why international safety standards have said that the voltage has to be, if the voltage is above 60, you should be monitoring the insulation in the whole system. if there is any voltage, if the chassis or the if the car is getting energized with the battery, then the one of the major reasons could be because every system is insulated, that the insulation got broken, or the insulation is, or somewhere, because wire has insulation around it, if the wire breaks and touching any metal part in the vehicle, that's going to give up voltage into the car. So when driver boots the vehicle, if the system is still on, if the high voltage is still on, then the driver is going to get shocked. So how do we avoid it is using this insulation monitoring device. So if this can help us in, even if the vehicle is in encountering accident, a literal vehicle. So when an accident, some scrapings happen, or if you are accelerating, so this scraping can peel off insulation and then cause more damage in accident than the physical impact due to electrical leakage. So this IMD has a sinusoidal wave passing from it generates a sinusoidal wave and it passes through the chassis and it receives back again. Okay, so when if there is a voltage leakage inside the chassis, the waveform of a sinusoidal, the waveform of a wave it is receiving will change according to the voltage that is applied across the chassis. So by that, it counts this sinusoidal waves every second, every millisecond. And then if there is a persistent change in the waveform it receives, it will shut down the system. And how it shut down the system is through the same component here. Okay, so it will should switch off the accumulator isolation delay, and then you will not be able to switch on car as well, and the car or a bike, electric bike, and it will be shut down. So this, apart from the battery pack, like apart from the functional component, this is also one of the major components that is going to be installed in any electric vehicle which is running above 60 volts. Okay, so the next is pre-charge circuit. Okay, this also applies when the voltage is again more than 60 volts. So what is pre-charge? So why do we actually require pre-charge in our car? Okay, or the electric vehicle or an electric bike. So is that in the controller, the controller is a component which actually supplies power to the motor. You know, the motor is what? Supplying power to the wheels. So in controller, when you are releasing, when you are applying 400 volts across the controller, when controller is first time applying power to the motor, it is a free path. There is no resistance inside the path. So when there is no resistance, what happens is the current flown will be very high. So then what happens? The whole electric vehicle powertrain will fry, because this can, when there is no resistance, when there is resistance close to zero, then the current drawn will be in thousands. So when 1,000 amps are being drawn, all the components in between battery pack and the motor are going to fire. So in order to avoid this, we should have a pre-charge circuit. So what is pre-charge? This is a battery. So pre-charge will connect the batteries to the controller here, the capacitors here, through a resistive path. So this resistor is called pre-charge. So it will the path will be connected to the resistor, and then the resistor will charge the capacitors inside the controller, and then capacitor will supply high current to the motor. So this whole setup is pre-charge, and once the capacitor is charged, that means there is a steady voltage inside, the voltage saturation happened inside the circuit, then the system doesn't draw high current from batteries. It might draw from the capacitor, that is not going to harm anyone, but it doesn't draw from battery. It will not fire up everything in between battery and the controller. So then it will switch to the main path. So the resistive path is cut off. So this system will also be there in our electric vehicle. And so this helps with the DC supply, the normal, the spikeless DC supply, and also protects the system from frying up. So the next component, which is the silent protector in our electric vehicle, is the inertia switch. Okay, so the inertia switch in electric vehicle does the same work as an inertia switch does in normal combustion vehicle. So what does it do is, whenever there's going to be impact, or whenever there's going to be, whenever there is hard braking or an impact with any other component, any other vehicle in front of us, so it will switch off the whole system. So it will switch, cut off the, again, it will cut off the AR here, the first switch here. So what does it do? Why should it switch off is, again, as I spoke before, when something happens, there will be a high voltage leak. Other than the impact causing you any harm, an electric harm will be more prevalent, more prevalent than the impact harm, because the cars are designed for impact safety. Where what if because of that impact an electric leakage happens in system and driver gets shocked? All the safety features, airbags, everything will be going into vain. So in order to avoid that, they use impact switch. What does it do is, whenever there is a 9G, more than 9G of acceleration from the front of the rear, it's going to shut down the system. So it's manually shut down. So it is shut down and you cannot reset it electrically. So once you take it to the service center, the service center guy is going to manually reset the inertia switch or replace it if it is damaged in case. So if you see, this is the whole system that is behind the electric vehicle operation, other than motors and controllers and battery pack. So this is how electric vehicle circuit, the powertrain, is different from a normal remote control car powertrain. So I hope I've given you enough information regarding how is electric vehicle design and engineered different from normal physics description we always remember about. So now we'll go to the part which is driving the electric vehicle, which is creating, which is satisfying the purpose of an IC engine inside the car. So what exactly runs the vehicle is electric motor and an electric controller part. So battery pack is a store, energy store, and that energy is converted into motion with the help of controller and the motor. So what does controller do? That I'll explain in a few minutes. So what is motor in general? So the general definition, like if someone says a motor to us, what comes into our mind is an electric motor, like fan or a pump motor, right? So but what is the actual definition of motor? The actual definition of motor is any object that converts any form of energy into the motion. So the picture you see here is a biological motor, a motor that works in our cells, that transport proteins, all the required proteins, enzymes from one cell to other, inside cell from one part, like a nucleus to the vacuole to nucleus. So even before human invented a motor, like even for the human to be created, there is motor already created by the nature. So when I learned it, I was like bewildered. This is thing everyone has to be learned. No, so that I put up this motor inside the presentation today. So these motors are called flagellar motors. So the basic definition. So yeah, now I think I can have cleared you with the example also that. This is called motor. Anything, any object that can convert motion, any energy into the motion is called motor. So what is there in the electric car? Electric car, we have an electric motor that converts electric energy into the mechanical energy. So even engine is a motor. So if you recall the definition of, like, we call it as a motorcycle. We don't call it as an engine cycle. So even engine is a motor, but engine runs with an electrochemical chemical reaction, but the motor runs with an electromagnetic reaction.